The Iron Golem believe themselves destined to create the weapons and the armor for the armies of the Everchosen, but first they must prove themselves worthy by defeating anything and anyone that stands in their way. In this video, we're going to show you how to paint these miniatures in the color scheme that you can see on the box, which is the metallic red armor with the brass trim. We're going to do so by using an Iron Legionnaire miniature, but by following the method and techniques we're going to show you in this video, you'll be able to paint any of the miniatures inside the box. Now, I really like these miniatures and I've been looking forward to painting these models for a long, long time. So without further ado, let's get started. As with any Citadel miniature, the very first thing that you need to do after you've built them is to undercoat them. And for these models, we recommend using Mechanica Standard Grey Spray, which you can see is what I've sprayed my miniature with just here. The reason for this is that this is an excellent starting point for the pallid skin tone, which we're going to start painting first. And the first paint we need for that is Iron Rack Skin. Now remember to give each of your paints a really good shake before you use each one. And the brush I'm going to be using to apply this is a medium base brush because it's a really good size for the kind of area that we want to cover here. Now throughout this video, you're going to see me using a palette and I recommend you do the same. And to use it, what you do is just get a dollop of the paint like this and put it onto the palette in a little puddle like that. And then you're able to add a touch of water to it. So just a small amount and mix it in. And then you can use the palette here to make sure that your brush isn't overloaded as well. There's a whole number of reasons why you go through this and thin the paint down. The reason for it, first of all, is that it means that your paint will go a little bit further. It also means it will dry smoother and it gives you more control over it as well. So it's a really good little technique to get a hang of. But as you can see, I've got the paint thinned down and I haven't overloaded the brush. So now I can start applying this onto the skin. Now the skin is scattered all over the miniature and in some cases it's quite hidden away. For example, the neck just here and the chin goes all the way down underneath the collar and you just need to make sure that you get it all. You'll notice as I'm doing this I'm actually catching other details in the model such as the helmet, but don't worry about that because we will neaten up those details as we go along. For now, all you need to concentrate on doing is making sure that you catch all the skin, so keep looking around the model making sure you base coat all of it. I've finished applying the Iron Rack skin now and you can see, like I said, I've not been particularly neat to it, but don't worry because we can neaten up later on as we add more colours to the model. The next stage though is to add some shade to the skin to help bring out the definition of it, and for this what we need is Agrax Earthshade. Now straight out of the pot, Agrax Earthshade is a little bit too strong for the kind of effect that we want here, so what we're going to do is dilute it using Lamium Medium. The reason why we're using Lamium Medium instead of water is because Lamium Medium is essentially shade without any pigment in it, so by mixing it with other shade you dilute the colour without changing the properties of the paint. So this way we'll still get a nice smooth finish once it's dry. It's much better doing this way than using water. So what we're going to do is make about a 50-50 mix of this, and I'm going to start out with the Agrax Earthshade so you can see what I'm doing. I'm using a medium shade brush for this, and what I'm going to do is just get a little puddle of it like this on the palette. So I've got two brushfuls there like that, and then we need the medium. Now be careful not to contaminate it with any pigment, so make sure you wash your brush before you get any. There we go, make sure that's dry, and then we want roughly the same amount. So that's one brushful, and then two. There we go, I'll put them next to each other on the palette, can now mix them together, and there we go, we've got the diluted colour. So with this done, all we've got to do is start painting this over the skin. So I'll start doing that now on the arm here, and you can see as I paint this on, it flows into the recessed detail and gives us that really nice smooth definition on the muscles. So all we need to do now is paint this all over the skin and then give the miniature about 20 minutes to dry. The shade is now completely dry and you can see what definition it's given to the skin. But with that done, we can now move on to the next phase, which is to layer the skin to really start to bring out some of that raised detail on it. For this, the colour we need is Deepkin Flesh, and I'm going to be applying this using a medium layer brush because we need more control now over where exactly we're applying this. So as before with the base paint, use the palette to get some paint on there like that, then add some water to it to thin it down. And what we're aiming to do here is to make the paint a little bit more transparent. So add a bit more water until it's this kind of consistency here. You can see it's a little bit runny, not overly so, so that it's not going out of control, but I can easily paint it by just running the brush along like this, and I can twist the bristles to bring the brush to a nice point, so I've got control over where exactly I'm going to apply it. And what we're looking to do is to paint this onto the raised areas of the muscles whilst avoiding areas where more shade settled. So the back of this arm just here is a great example of that. You can see the darker lines in between the muscles where the shade is. What I'm going to do is paint this paint onto the raised areas, avoiding those darker lines like this. So this way, you see, I'm just emphasizing the raised areas of the muscle whilst keeping the definition of the recessed areas. So what you need to do now is just carry on doing this all over the skin of your miniature, and this is the point to really be as neat as you can. The neater you are here, the better the final result is going to be, so just really take your time. With the skin now layered, you can see the features are standing out really nicely, and we just have one more step to do to finish off the skin, and that is to highlight it. Now for this, the colour we need is Pallid Witch Flesh, and we're only going to be applying a very small amount of this, so I recommend using a small airbrush to apply it. And what we need to do is, as before, to get a small amount of this paint onto the palette like this, and then add some water to thin it down. And this time, the thing you really must do is just to make sure that you twist your brush as you drag it along, just to get rid of the excess paint and bring the bristles to a nice point. Because what we're looking to do here is to paint lines following along all the sharpest, most defined features on the skin. So for example, on the hand, if we take a look at this, the fingers are a really obvious and clear example of this. So what you want to do is just paint a line going along each finger like that to help it stand out. But also, you can see the tendons appearing on top of the hand as well. So what I need to do, just paint a line running along each of those like that. Just very gently, just a small highlight to help that feature stand out. There's other features to look out for as well. For example, on the head, obviously most of it's covered by the helmet, but we can see the jawline, so it's worth going along there a little bit as well. And on these parts on the neck going down there as well, just small lines like that. And as for the curves on the muscles, if there's any areas where the light catches a lot, for example, just around that crest of that muscle there, just paint a small line just following along like that just to finish it off. So all you need to do now is carry on doing this all across the skin as before, just really taking your time and being as neat as you can. And with that highlight applied, the unhealthy pallid skin is now complete, and we can move on to the next main feature of the miniature, which is that metallic red armour. Now the first stage for painting this armour is to base coat all of it using Balthazar Gold. I'm going to be applying this mostly using a medium base brush, but it's a good idea to have a small airbrush on hand because some of the metallic detail is very small, so you'll need that fine brush to get to it. But as before, use the palette to get the paint ready, putting a bit on like that, and then thinning it down so it's nice and smooth. You can see it's quite thick straight out of the pot, this one, so we want it brought down to about there. And once you've done so, make sure you don't have too much paint on your brush, and all you've got to do is start looking around for all the armour and any other details that you want to be brass. So I can start on the shoulder pad just here, base coating all of it like this, and going onto the helmet. But whenever you get close to that skin, just be really careful and just really take your time so that you don't go onto the skin by accident there like that. Now you can see, I can still see some of that grey undercoat through this colour, so what I'm going to do is apply this, then once it's completely dry, I'll apply a second thin coat in exactly the same way so I have a nice strong shiny colour before I move on. Also worth noting at this stage is to keep an eye out for any other details you want to be brass. For example, any bangles on the arms, such as the one we've got just there, or any metallic details of this colour on the weapons, be sure to base coat those at this stage as well. With that base coat applied, we're now ready to move on to shading all the bronze, and for this we need Reichland Flesh Shade, which will give a really nice warm finish to the bronze and will match that red armour perfectly. Now to apply this, what you need is a medium layer brush, because we don't want to go overboard in how much we apply here. You need to keep it under control and only on that bronze armour. So make sure you use your palette here so you can gauge exactly how much is on your brush, and once you've got a good amount loaded on there, all you need to do is start painting this all over that bronze. So as you're applying this, just be really careful so it doesn't go out of control. You don't want to get it onto the skin. So as you can see, I'm applying it here, I'm just being as neat as I can, and once you've finished applying it, give it around about 20 minutes to dry before you move on to the next step. Once the shade is dry, you'll see all the features of the armour clearly standing out, so we're now ready to move on to the next step, which is painting that distinctive red on the flat panels of the armour. For this, the paint we need is a contrast paint called Flesh Tearer's Red, and I'm going to be applying this using a medium layer brush, but feel free to go for a small layer brush if you're more comfortable with that, because for this stage you just need to be really controlled about where you're applying this. So use the palette to help with that, make sure that brush is loaded but not overloaded, so just twist away the excess paint like that so you get down to that fine tip. And then what we're looking to do is to essentially colour in the middle parts of the armour where we want them to be red. So if we take a look at the breastplate, for example, around here, what I'm going to do is just be really neat painting this contrast paint onto that flat part in the centre, going up to but not onto the trim there like that. So you see, it just takes one coat, paint it in like that, and there you go, you get that really nice metallic red. And there we are, as easy as that, we've got that distinctive metallic red. And all we need to do is highlight all that red now and all the bronze at the same time. And for this, we just need one colour, which is Liberator Gold. I'm going to be applying this using a small layer brush now because the technique we're going to be using is called edge highlighting, and you need a fine brush to be able to do this. As always, use the palette here to help set up the paint for it. So just add a touch of water to it. There we go. And then twist away the excess paint off your brush. And then what we're looking to do is to, well, with edge highlighting, it's exactly what it sounds like. You look for all the edges on the armour and you apply a highlight along that edge. So on that breastplate once more, it's a great example here, because in this case, we can actually use the side of the brush. What I'm going to do is just apply a line along the edge of that trim just there. And so I'm just going to graze it with the brush like that to get that bright, shiny bronze shining through there like that. Now on the red armour panels, we just do the exact same thing. So for example, the shoulder plate just here, I'm just going to angle the brush so I can catch that edge the side of my brush like that, and all you do is just run all the way around like that. So now all you need to do is just highlight all the bronze and red details like this, just really taking your time and being as neat as you can once more. And with that highlight applied, the red armor is now complete, and we just need to move on to the remaining small details on the miniature to finish it off. So what we need to do now is apply some lead belch to base coat all the silver details, such as the chains, and then we're going to move on to Thunderhawk blue, and this will be to base coat the weapon grips. But first of all, we need lead belcher, and I'm going to be applying this using my medium layer brush. And as always, use the palette to get this paint ready, just putting it on there like that, and adding a touch of water to thin it down. And then once you've done so, all you've got to do is start identifying all the parts that you want to be silver. Now, of course, there are a lot of chains on this miniature, including a lot of chainmail, so you want to make sure that you paint all of this. So you don't have to get in between every single link, but you want to get a good coating across all those details like that. When you get to the large chains that are going around the waist and up to the body, just really take your time as you base coat these details to make sure that you're painting in the correct parts. Finally, you want to look at the weapons as well, and for these, just decide which parts you want to be silver and apply lead belcher to all those areas. And once you finish picking out all the details that you want to be silver, you're then ready for Thunderhawk blue to base coat in all of the weapon grips. And there we are, with those details now base coated, we're ready to shade them and to highlight them. So for this, we're going to start out with Norn Oil, for which we're going to shade both the silver and the weapon grips. But then we're going to move on to Agrax Earth Shade, just for some small patches on the metal to make it look a little bit grimy. After this, we're ready to highlight the metal using Stormhost Silver, and then for the weapon grips, we'll need Rust Grey. But first of all, we need Norn Oil, and like when we were doing that red earlier on, I'm going to apply this using the medium layer brush, because we don't want to overdo this and lose control of the paint. So remember to use your palette to help with that. Just get a little puddle like that, and then draw the paint from there. All you need to do now is start applying this directly over all the silver details, but also the weapon grips as well. Whilst you're doing this, keep an eye out on your miniature to see if there's any studs in the flesh, and if you spot any, paint some Norn Oil over these as well. Once the shade is dry, we're going to add some small amounts of Agrax Earthshade to the silver to make it look a little bit grimy and a little bit mucky. Once that shade is dry, you're then ready to highlight all the silver detail with Stormhost Silver. And like when we were highlighting the armour earlier on, we want to edge highlight here, picking out all the sharpest edges and details as neatly as possible. Also at this stage, if your model has studs on it, such as the ones on the arms here, you just want to pick these out with little bits of this colour, like this. And as for all the chainmail, all you need to do for this is lightly draw your brush across the texture like this, just to catch the raised areas. And finally, edge highlight the grips of the weapons using Rust Grey. And with those grips highlighted, the model is very nearly finished and ready for basing. There's just one more thing that we're going to do before we do the basing, and that is an optional thing, and is to add a little bit of verdigris to some of the bronze, which is very useful in your miniature if you have very large areas of bronze that you want to break up a little bit. Now, to do this, you need Nylac Oxide, and to apply it, what you need is a small airbrush, because with something like this, you don't want to do too much of it, because it can mess up a model. So you just want small amounts. Just get a little bit on your palette like this to help control how much is on your brush. Get rid of the excess, and then what you need to do is look on your miniature for areas of bronze where water would collect if the model was out in the rain. For example, on the hammer here, we're looking at areas such as just underneath that bolt there, just a small amount, add a little hint of colour to that area. And there we are, with those small bits of verdigris added, the miniature is now ready to be based. For this, we're going to begin using Astrogranite, which is a grey textured paint. And to apply this kind of paint, what you need is one of these texture tools, because you use the shovel side of this to get a good scoop of the paint, like that. And then on the basing miniature, just look for an open space. So the front of it just there is a great starting point. What you do is just put the texture paint on it there like that, and then use the tool to start manipulating it round the base, switching to the narrower side when you get close to the model's feet, so you have a little bit more control. Once you've finished applying this to the top of the base, give the miniature around about an hour to dry before you move on to the next step. Once that texture paint is completely dry, you're then ready to give it some depth by applying some shade paint over it. And for this, we need Agrax Earthshade applied using your medium shade brush. And as always, it's a good idea to use the palette here, but you don't need to dilute this colour at all. Instead, just load up a good amount on your brush and just start painting it onto that texture. And the only area you need to be careful of is when you get close to the miniature's feet, just taking your time going around like that so that you don't get any onto the flesh. Once the shade is completely dry, you're then ready to really bring out that texture by dry brushing it using Tyrant Skull. Now, to dry brush, what you need is a small dry brush, and to do the technique, what you do is just get a little bit of this paint on the tip of your brush like this, and then get some tissue and use it to work the paint into the bristles and then remove the excess paint as well. So by the time you finish doing this, you only have a very small amount of paint on your brush. Once you've done this, all you got to do is start drawing that paint back and forth across the texture on the base, and you'll see immediately the residue that's left on the brush will catch the raised details and give a really nice effect on the texture of this textured paint. So once done this, there's just two more things left to do, and the first is to put on a grass tuft, and I'm going to use some Midland tufts for this, and then you just need to paint the rim of the base, and for this miniature I'm going to use Steel Legion Drab. And with the base fully painted, this Iron Legionnaire is complete, ready to go forth and win glory and renown in the name of the Iron Golem. So when you paint these miniatures, there's a few key things to remember, and the first is that it's a good idea to start out by painting their flesh. The main reason for this is it allows you to access all that tricky to reach detail without worrying about catching any of the armour by accident. Now the second thing is when you're painting that armour, we use a contrast paint to get that shiny metallic red. When you're doing this, you need to make sure you apply the correct amount of contrast paint. You want enough that you're going to evenly cover the area that you're painting, but not so much that you swamp the area and lose control of the paint and also take away some of that shine from the metallic paint beneath. Finally, when you're doing your highlights, as always, be as neat as you can, because the neater you are, the better the final result is going to be. But there we go, we really hope that you've enjoyed this video and that it's inspired you to paint your Iron Golem Warband. Now remember, even though we painted an Iron Legionnaire as our example, by following the methods and techniques we've shown you, you can paint any member of the Warband. Even the Ogre Breacher, despite being substantially bigger, is still painted in the same way. So have fun, and we'll see you all again soon.